Welcome to Take Good Care Podcast,
an endeavor that grew out of our love for obstetrics and gynecology. Our aim and mission is to serve as a source of vital information for women of all races, ages, and walks in life.
I am Dr. Miranda Williams.
I am Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Green.
Welcome to our show. Welcome to this episode of Take Good Care Podcast. I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Green.
We are so excited that we are back. We took a little hiatus from season 5. And as you may notice, those of you who are listening to us and watching us on our YouTube channel or on our website, we have a wonderful guest here today. We are so excited. We mentioned when we took a break that we were really expanding what the podcast is able to offer. And to do that, we want to bring in some subject guests as well as just some very interesting people that we think our audience will find very engaging. So today we're excited that we have a wonderful colleague in our medical community here in the southern part of Metro Atlanta who's here to talk to us about her subject matter. And I'm going to introduce her in just a second, as well as just to talk about life, being a business owner, being a mom, being a wife, doing all the things that we all as women tend to do. So we have Dr. Erin King-Mullins, who's with us today. And she is a colorectal surgeon, has done phenomenal things in terms of her training and everything that she brings to our medical community. So I'm going to give her an opportunity just to talk to you, to let you know who she is, where she's from, give some of her personal information she'd like to share, as well as what her medical specialty is all about.
Hi, ladies.
Hi,
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
And listen, I have to actually start off by giving myself a pat on the back. We are now 18 days in the new year, and I think I've only written 2023 one time. So.
That's you are doing good.
I think a part of it was that I really wanted to get out of 2023.
I was just about to say that. I was so happy 2023 was gone. I haven't written it once. So.
Awesome.
But yeah, thank you so much for having me today. I've listened and seen you all both on the podcast and just in person, in action at the hospital. And I will truly tell you that you are three ladies that, you know, I really admire, look up to holistically, you know, medically, spiritually, as I think we've had some great conversations, you know, amongst ourselves about various topics. And as now entrepreneurs and business owners. So as you mentioned, I'm Erin King-Mullins. I'm a colorectal surgeon here in the Southern Metro Atlanta. I've been in practice 10 years this year, which is pretty crazy to me.
That's an accomplishment.
Thank you. And I just ventured out on last year to start my own practice.
Congratulations.
So, thank you. So I just feel like this point, you know, with the ups and downs of a new practice, and I actually had my second child last year, basically right in the middle of doing the construction on the new office. So those are just kind of some of the ups and downs that kind of wanted me to move forward. And I'm sure we'll get to some other topics later. I lost my father last year. So there was just a lot that went on. And, you know, coming off the tails of a pandemic into the plateau of everything that happens after that, and the social unrest. I mean, it was just so much over the past couple of years. And I just feel like 2024 is just a good place for me to not necessarily start over, but at least unpack a lot of those things in a way that's functional for both myself and my patients moving forward.
So. Absolutely. So, Dr. Green, do you have some specific questions you want to get us started off with?
I do. Welcome, Erin. First off, I kind of wanted to know the how and the why, because, you know, most people may or may not know female colorectal surgeons. There aren't a lot of y'all. There's just not. And so I kind of, as I was thinking about this the other day, I said, you know, why? Why colorectal surgery? Why did you pick that particular specialty? And then my other question was how. And so that would get into how you got, you said you just, you know, went into solo practice, your own practice. You've been doing this for 10 years, which I was not aware of till just now. But kind of your background and, you know, how you got into this. Because I can imagine that it may not have been your first choice, or maybe you didn't even think about it, or maybe you didn't even know about it. I don't know. But how did you, Erin, get to be a colorectal surgeon.
So oftentimes I answer that in that it found me, my specialty, my search, like everything, you know, and I could try to, I'm going to try to compact this because there's a lot that went into it. But, you know, when I started medical school, you know, the first question that you get is, what do you want to do? What do you want to do? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do, but, I told everybody, I know one thing I don't want to do was surgery. That was, you know, I had this whole concept of what a surgeon looked like, how they behaved. And so my mentor, actually, I went to Emory Med School, and I was paired with very early on Dr. Stacy Higgins, who's still there, an internal medicine physician there. And she said, be careful what you say.
Yes. God's listening. God has a humor.
Yes. Yes. He laughs at your plans. So I started my rotations. I was assigned surgery first, and I was like, yes, I'm going to get it over with so I can really get on to what I really like so I can make my decision. And I somehow, like, fell in love with it. And then after that, I just really couldn't. And I tried so hard to get it out of my mind. Because, again, still, even with some of the interactions that I had with the surgeons that were there, there were some people that were nicer. But, you know, there wasn't anyone that looked like me. There wasn't anyone that I could really connect with kind of background-wise, how you get to this point. And so I just tried my darndest to not like it and find something else that I liked. And I really enjoyed my OBGYN rotation, honestly. Well, mostly the GYN part now, in retrospect, not so much the OB part. So, So I had some great experiences there. Thought I was going to ultimately be a trauma surgeon. All the shady, grady nights, you know, just having fun. And at that time, we had two of the biggest and hottest trauma surgeons there at Grady who took me under their wing and mentored me. So I went back home to Orlando, level one trauma center down there, and within 6 months was like, nope, trauma's not it. So I then just said, okay, I'm going to be a general surgeon. But got paired up with some great colorectal surgeons down there. And first off, I didn't even know colorectal was a specialty when I even started residency. So doing those rotations. And over time, I realized that it matched me the most, I think, with some. I like to do a lot of different things. So we do, you know, talking to patients and counseling them in office, small procedures in office, small procedures at the hospital, big procedures, colorectal cancers and Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis. And so I tell myself and patients and colleagues, I feel like a colorectal surgeon is kind of like the epitome of all things medicine and science. Again, I'm a nutritionist sometimes. I counsel people on their diet, prevention with the colon cancer awareness and screening. Sometimes I'm their psychologist when I'm giving bad news, telling them they need an ostomy and walking them through that, walking them through those difficult conversations with their family. But then I'm their champion. I'm their cheerleader. You know, when we do that major surgery and we cure them from their cancer and I get to see them and them grow up. I mean, I've seen patients get married and have kids and see their kids grow up. So it's literally a little bit of everything that keeps me going.
That's awesome. Yeah. That is. So much of what you said before you go on, Karen, just resonates, I think, with all of us. In our first season, we did our quote unquote origin stories about how we ended up in the various fields and very similar types of scenarios. Some of us went in with a little bit more of a decision about what direction we wanted to, not so much for others. So I think what you said, how it found you, that is just, that resonates, I think, with us. Because sometimes you go in thinking one thing and you come out with something totally different. And just your passion for what you do comes through. So, which is why we really enjoy sharing and sending our patients to you for consultations and things like that.
And it's great that you found what fits you, because a lot of people don't. They just kind of get stuck in a track that kind of was maybe laid out for them, or they felt they should do and aren't very happy. So it's not very many people that can say they found what's their true passion, what's their true love.
It's interesting because I had never heard of colorectal surgery coming through residency either. And so as you told your story, it's interesting how I enjoyed my surgery rotation, but I did not like the surgeons. And I think it was because they didn't, in my mind, take care of patients. And so the way you describe colorectal surgery is kind of how I see gynecology now, mm-hmm. you know, for our practice, for myself, you know, that we're taking care of our patients, you know. Mm-hmm. So we've seen patients that start off as little and we, you know, we treat them for this thing, we treat them for that thing, you know, we give them bad news, we give them good news. And so that whole concept of being holistic about taking care of our patients is one of the reasons why, you know, we continue to do what we do, mm-hmm. why we started this podcast. Mm-hmm. And that just, you know, that really resonated with me. And I'm just, I really appreciate you telling that story because mm-hmm. I that's what I really wanted to know, you know, mm-hmm. why. And, mm-hmm. and you answered the how.
Yeah. Anything else?
No.
All right, Dr. Guthrie.
So, well, one of my questions was what Karen asked you. What do you see, say to another woman to encourage her in a male-dominated field?
Know your truth, know your worth, and know who you're serving.
That's excellent. Say that again.
Hold on, because I made it up on the fly.
Say that again. That needs to be.
Let me write that down.
Know your truth, know your worth, and know who you're caring for. And I think that has springboarded a little bit over time, again, in a male-dominated, particularly a white male-dominated, you know, field. You sometimes get bogged down in this idea that you have to compete. And mm-hmm. while this is true, you do have to compete because mm-hmm. Obviously we have to, you know, mm-hmm. put food on the table. Like business. At the end of the day, mm-hmm. you have to put food on the table. Mm-hmm. But who are you serving? Who's mm-hmm. coming to see you and why? Mm-hmm. And so in a lot of ways, sometimes that competition just gets laid to rest by nature of, you know, you don't all run in the same circles. Mm-hmm. You don't all necessarily mm-hmm. see the same demographic. Mm-hmm. And so be proud of that. You know, a lot of people are like, oh, man, you're brave. You're crazy to leave, you know, kind of one of the biggest institutions in the metro Atlanta area and just go by yourself and start your own. And I'm like, mm-hmm. I don't have to see every butt in Atlanta. You know, I don't. Like, I just need to see enough to make sure that I'm, you know, fulfilling my needs and paying, you know, paying the bills. And once you kind of recognize some of those things, mm-hmm. It frees you up in so many different ways. And you know, this is, I think we're coming up on the years of the underdog now.
Mm, very true.
Patients mm-hmm. want to see their provider. They want mm-hmm. to see who they chose. Mm-hmm. They want to feel cared for and mm-hmm. nurtured in that mm-hmm. environment. Mm-hmm. And they don't want to feel like they're a part of an algorithm.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. you know, just a number. And I think the same thing for physicians. Mm-hmm. They want to feel mm-hmm. like they're, you know, valued and they're not just a number, and that, you know, if they have an issue, don't just send an email to this nebulous place. Like, mm-hmm. who can I talk mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. about actual change? Mm-hmm. And so that's one of I think that's what's motivated me to continue. And on mm-hmm. those nights where you want to cry mm-hmm. and be like, what the heck did I do?
Right. Mm-hmm.
You get that feedback from the mm-hmm. patients who sometimes, like, you walk in the room and they mm-hmm. say, you know, hey, I don't even know you yet, but before talking to you, thank you for having mm-hmm. a person answer mm-hmm. the phone.
Right.
Thank you for getting back to me. Thank you. Mm-hmm. You know, just kind of just those little things. Mm-hmm. And so they appreciate that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You have something else? I was going to make a quick comment. I just said, we've talked about COVID, right? And how COVID changed everything, mm. you know, forever. And it brought some things into sharp focus, mm-hmm. you know, about what's really important, mm-hmm. you know, how do we serve the community that we serve the best?
Right.
You know, one of the things, and I know you and I have had this conversation, we've talked about, the three of us, when we made the decision to go to a 4-day work week, it wasn't a business decision. You know, it was a quality of life decision for us. It was a decision to try to be very efficient in how we were running our business, but also realizing that for me and for us to serve our patients the best, we have to have a balance that we were just not getting.
Yeah.
You know, it had gotten so crazy, you know, doing all the things.
You know, that we talk about all the things.
All the things. The businesswoman things, the mommy things, the wife things, the significant other things, this daughter things,
right.
You know, all the things. And then you get to the end of your day and you have nothing left.
Yeah.
And you can't, we talk about it all the time. You have to put put your own oxygen mask on first, because you can't run around putting everybody else's mask on, and you're going to pass out.
Right.
So thank you mm-hmm. for that.
And then another question I was going to ask, what are some of the inequities you see treating colon disease?
So I think, that could be a whole episode.
I know. We had an episode on
it. We have to bring it back.
Yeah. You know, I think the first thing is just conversations. You know, and part of it is some patients feel comfortable in certain situations and with certain providers. And not only outside of that, some providers feel comfortable with certain patients. And so they don't know exactly, you know, what's medical care versus like, am I getting in your business? Like, you know what I'm saying? And so coming at the same place, I think, you know, the biggest inequities that we face are, you know, when we talk about colorectal cancer screening, there are studies that show the number one reason people don't get screening is because they were never told to. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, for whatever reason, not blaming any providers, some guidelines and recommendations change that other specialties may not be aware of. So they're just not, you know, alerting, you know, the patients when those times have changed. Mm-hmm. Also, you know, offering certain services, you know, making sure that you're fully understanding the full complement of that patient. Are they the primary breadwinner for their family? Mm-hmm. What other responsibilities and things that they may or may not have? So I think all of those things, I think it all boils down to the communication that leads to the inequities and whatever that may be, diagnosis, right, treatment, screening, medications, you know, whatever's offered.
Mm-hmm. And absolutely, for that, you have to know the patient. You have to actually have had a conversation with the patient. Otherwise, you're just giving them an order and hoping they fulfill that. And they really, you don't know why they can't.
Yeah,
because sometimes if you don't talk to them, like I said, you can hand them the paper and say, hey, you need to have a colonoscopy, get it scheduled.
Right.
But they have to understand the why.
Yeah.
And like you said, you know, you never know what's their life situation. Are they the breadwinner? Like, I can't take a day off. Mm-hmm. Well, what else can I do?
Right.
You know, or stress mm-hmm. the importance to mm-hmm. that.
So. And kind of like follow up to that, you know, while, you know, as a colorectal surgeon, not just procedurally because I enjoy doing it, I know that, you know, the best yield for colorectal cancer screening and prevention is going to be the colonoscopy. If you mm-hmm. see a polyp, you can remove it right then and there, mm-hmm. you're one and done. Mm-hmm. And a lot of patients will ask about some of those other kind of stool-based studies and mm-hmm. things like that. And their socioeconomic situation plays a role into which they can do. Now, mm-hmm. so while I would prefer someone get a colonoscopy, if they have a situation where they can't do it, then by all means, any test is better than nothing.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes it doesn't even just boil down to insurance coverage. It's, you know, the colonoscopy is a procedure. So mm-hmm. now you're engaging a second party mm-hmm. who has to potentially take off work, mm-hmm. Bring this person to work, or even if it's not that they have to take off work, caring for the kids. Mm-hmm. Someone has to make sure that the children are taken care of and they can't be out of pocket for so many hours, mm-hmm. you know, escorting someone to the procedure. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. there's a lot of logistics that go around with it too, that, you know, those conversations need to be had, because again, I'd rather somebody, if I can't do a colonoscopy for you, let me know, then let's look at some other options mm-hmm. so we can just make sure you're at least taken care of.
Great. And that's a great segue. What I wanted to do at this point, we've done a couple of episodes and shows where we talk about what are the screening guidelines, why it's important, you know, who may be a good candidate for some of the stool-based tests versus those who need to have something more invasive and more advanced. So can you just kind of talk about that a little bit in general, what the screening guidelines are, and again, why it's so important for people to be screened?
Yeah, definitely. I think the biggest thing is to first provide the education on what screening is compared to a diagnostic colonoscopy, right? So screening means that you are of age, risk, family history to where you're not having symptoms, we need to actively go start looking for a potential problem. So mm-hmm. a mammogram after a certain age, prostate screening for men after a certain age. Mm-hmm. So screening, you know, the number one risk factor for colorectal cancer is just age, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So the U.S. Preventative Services Task Force, they updated the screening guidelines for mm-hmm. all comers back in 2021 to the age of 45. Mm-hmm. All comers, meaning men and women. You don't mm-hmm. know how many men get dragged in by their wife. Mm-hmm. And I told him he needed a colonoscopy. And I'm like, did you have yours? She was like, no, I don't need one. You got a colonoscopy. So men and women, all comers age of 45. Mm-hmm. Caveat to that, if you have a family history of not only colorectal cancer, colon polyps. Polyps mm-hmm. are a precancerous state. Mm-hmm. So we need to know about that. If there are other cancers that run in the family, all of those things need to be provided so that you could be recommended to the appropriate screening age for your colonoscopy. And then the frequency with which you need it is based upon what is found on your examination, but also mm-hmm. that family history. So mm-hmm. once you get beyond there, you really got to talk to your provider and know your specific situation mm-hmm. on how often to get it. Mm-hmm. So that's it. And so then there's the gold standard would be the colonoscopy. It's what we call as both diagnostic and therapeutic, mm-hmm. meaning if I find a polyp, I can remove it right then and there, send mm-hmm. it off to the lab. We mm-hmm. can know what type of polyp it is so we can, again, know your risk. So mm-hmm. I can do something about it if I see it. Mm-hmm. If you do some of those other stool-based tests, what they're testing for is maybe microscopic blood in the bowel movements or abnormal cells. If that comes back abnormal, then you have to follow that up with a colonoscopy to figure out why What's it was abnormal. Mm-hmm. However, those tests are not for everybody. Those are not for people who have a family history of mm-hmm. colon cancer, or mm-hmm. if they've already had a polyp in the past, mm-hmm. or if they experience bleeding, even if it's just intermittent bleeding from hemorrhoids or something like that. Mm-hmm. Again, you know, something may come back abnormal and now we don't know if something's really going on, or is it just aggravated by, you know, maybe you had a hemorrhoid or something going mm-hmm. on. So, mm-hmm. So that's the kind of concept around screening for colorectal cancer. The one thing that I always, always, always stress to people mm-hmm. is the other reason to do a colonoscopy is for diagnosis. If you have a problem, so it doesn't matter what age, you should obviously talk to your provider about something. Mm-hmm. You have the change in your bowels that, you know, is different for you when it mm-hmm. persists. Mm-hmm. Blood or something, abdominal pain, something new or different that persists. A colonoscopy is also a diagnostic tool, just like CT, X-ray, blood work, mm-hmm. or whatever. It mm-hmm. can be used to find out mm-hmm. why you're having a symptom. Mm-hmm. And so I think these are conversations we're having more and more about, mm-hmm. you know, a younger person goes and they have a complaint and someone's like, you know, any provider can do it. Understanding, looking at their family history. Oh, you're young. You know, mm-hmm. it's probably just a hemorrhoid or this mm-hmm. and that. You don't have a family history. Mm-hmm. You know, if something persists, we should really look.
I appreciate you pointing that out. We definitely try to encourage our patients to get the screening tests based on what the recommendations are, whether it's age, family history, those kinds of things. Everyone, I think, us included, truth be told, you know, push back a little bit on the colonoscopy yeah. just because of the logistics. But also, some people think it's, you know, it's the prep, it's this, it's that, it's the other thing. But I think your point is it's a one and done, you know. The biggest issue we have with those things that are bad, meaning cancer, precancerous conditions, is the delay in the diagnosis, mm-hmm. which then delays the treatment. And so we really try and encourage patients, you know, don't think about the possible inconveniences of the test, because cancer is a whole hell of a lot worse.
Yes.
So us included have had to get over it. And figure out a way to make it work. Because again, you want to think of the long game, right? Not just the day or maybe 2 days with the prep of the colonoscopy as being inconvenient, logistics, all of those things, because you want to make sure our whole motto is you want to live a long life. You want to live a long and healthy life. Yes. You want to be able to do the things that you want to do with your friends and your family and just have a great life. And, when a screening test like a colonoscopy can be both diagnostic and therapeutic, one and done, let's get it out of there. If there's something that needs to be removed, it can be done and then you can go on. Yeah. So really appreciate that.
And you brought up a couple of points that that I talked to with my patients a little bit about. That is number one, when you have your annual visits with your providers, whether it's your GYN or your primary care doctor, part of the updates that you need to provide is also your changes in your family history, right? Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. so, you know, if, yeah, last year you had your colonoscopy and you were squeaky clean, mm-hmm. but your sibling had a colonoscopy and polyps removed, now your 10 years are out the window.
Exactly.
Your family history is different. So mm-hmm. now you're on a 5-year schedule. Mm-hmm. So we have to update family changes mm-hmm. as well, so
Very
our providers
mm-hmm.
can guide us appropriately on mm-hmm. what we're at risk for. Mm-hmm. And then you hit the nail on the head when you're talking about you want to live a healthy, long life. You know, sometimes I come at people with the angle of, okay, do you have children? Yes. Okay. Okay. You would do anything for your children, right? You jump in front of a moving train. You jump in front of a bullet, lift a car. They're like, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So why not live for your children? That why part. Not make sure you're there that for part. Them, mm-hmm. but also help them know what their risks are. If mm-hmm. you have something that you could pass on to them that can threaten them in their mm-hmm. life, mm-hmm. let's be accountable for that mm-hmm. and make sure we get those tests
Excellent.
Done.
Yeah. Excellent. Absolutely.
And that's so true. So, mm-hmm. as Dr. Williams was saying, because a lot of the hindrance for people getting it scheduled is the not knowing the exact kind of procedure, whatever.
Sure.
And for a lot of people, the prep is the issue. So, can you speak to the different types of preps and things like that? So that, because a lot of times they don't know, they're just hearing from yeah. other people.
Mm-hmm. Word of mouth.
Word of mouth, right?
Google.
And so, so can you speak to the preparation for colonoscopy and what that entails so that it may not be something as onerous as somebody may think, meaning, you know.
Sure.
So
there's different types of preps. So the whole concept of the prep is to prepare your colon, right? And so if we just start by the concept of what I'm looking for a colonoscopy, I'm looking for polyps, which are small little lumps or bumps, little molds that grow on the inside lining of the colon. So we have to get your colon cleaned out so those can be seen. And so you prepare your colon by taking a laxative preparation so you can evacuate all your bowels, essentially, and just get it down to, you know, liquids, mostly clear if we can. Mm-hmm. There's a litany of different preparation options, and they're very provider specific. Some doctors like one versus the other. And then some are better for certain patients based upon, you know, whatever history they may have, if they have heart problems or kidney problems with electrolyte issues. So it totally varies. So there's several options. But or if someone, you know, really lends towards constipation, sometimes we do have to prep you over a 2-day period because we don't want to waste your time. Right.
Exactly.
We want to make sure we can see what we can see. And so we can give you that long span of time mm-hmm. before you have to return. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, the people. So, yeah. And then before you are semi-fasting, so no solid foods. And the so jellos, juices, broths, popsicles, things that are clear. So that's what you're going to do that full day beforehand. Mm-hmm. Now, that strips people up sometimes because they freak out and then they go ham the day before that and eat everything in sight. And I'm like, no, that defeats the purpose. It's going to be okay. But yeah, so that's the preparation. You know, just really bad case of diarrhea the day before to clean the colon out. The procedure itself, you come in to wherever it's going to be performed. An IV gets placed, so you're sedated, so you don't feel it, you don't remember it, you're in whatever beach you want to go to. Mm-hmm. You come to pretty quickly, and the good news is that you actually know as soon as you wake up, your provider will talk to you and let you know if they found polyps or not. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, if polyps are found, they're biopsied, and then, you know, you await those results from the lab. Mm-hmm.
What's the average time of a colonoscopy? Because people don't even really...
Sure. So the procedure itself takes about 20 minutes, and that can be plus or minus 10 minutes, just depending on how many polyps are found or if they there's any additional procedures that need to be done. And so I just tell people, for me, I do mine at the hospital. So you're at the hospital total about 3 hours. Some of the more outpatient centers that are kind of a little bit smaller and have mm-hmm. less of the, you know, hubbub of a formal hospital, mm-hmm. You can be even in and out sooner than that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Very good. Excellent. Excellent questions. And this, again, just speaks to why we were so excited about finally being able to have guests come into our studio space or virtually. And I wanted, I'd be remiss if I did not take a little moment to give a shout out to our production team. Just Eldridge Media has been with us now for 2 years, and they have really, I think, taken our production value up. Tremendously. And so we're very appreciative of all that they have done and will continue to do because they just gave me an idea today that I've got to talk Dr. Green into. But anyway, I digress.
that was a louder ding.
So thank you, Just Eldridge Media, for all that you have done for Take Good Care podcast. And we're going to continue with these kinds of shows, getting guests in. And to that end, we've created an email. info@takegoodcarepodcast.com. So if you've enjoyed this, if you've enjoyed our wonderful guest and the information she has provided, please send us an email. If there's other information, different topics, things that you want us to delve into, please let us know about that. If you have some things that you want us to get to Dr. King-Mullins, send us those and we'll forward them on to her so we can make sure And before we end, I'll make sure she gives us her website information so that you all can search her out. But before we wind down this episode, we've alluded to the fact that we're all, you know, business women, wives, mothers, significant others, daughters. And you, congratulations, have stepped out into the world of business ownership. So what would you think has been your biggest challenge so far this first year of opening your medical practice?
Ooh, just learning the business of medicine.
That part. That part.
Just like, it's a whole new lingo, whole new language, whole new set of, but it's, you know, I've enjoyed the challenge. And, you know, I think just being in my own driver's seat just has made it worth it, because I understand that there's, you know, immediate reward for the effort that I'm putting in, and not just this like little portion of, you know, reward for that. So, yeah, I think so that's been just the biggest challenge, just balancing both the business and clinical. And I'm in a position where I'm now offloading, you know, some of the business, because I do have a practice manager now. Yay. So, yay.
That's helpful.
So that's, yeah, definitely, definitely helpful.
Yeah, one of the things we've really learned, especially these last few years, is building that team, building that support team around you, because your real job is taking care of the patients.
That's what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
That's what you're supposed to be doing.
And so sometimes the business things can start to filter in, and again, that work-life balance, remembering your why, your strengths, and who you're serving, means we have to sometimes build that team around you that can help you manage the business aspects of things while you continue to take great care of patients. And so, and then, similar to that, what do you think has been your biggest reward so far? What is the biggest lesson you think you've learned so far? Because you will continue to learn the lesson.
Yes. I think the biggest reward is that, like, people actually want me as their doctor. You know, just to, you go out and you just, you want to put it all on you. I've had a great training and a great experience, and you want to fill your CV, and you got all this stuff on your CV that you think people are going to drive to you. And there's, people don't always care about that.
Right.
So right. I think that's been the biggest reward. And then also just being able to truly interact with my patients in a way that I feel that I can meet them where they are and not have to worry about someone looking over my shoulder, like, why didn't you operate on that person? Or why, you know, I can truly offer patients like what they need when they need it, which has allowed me to be a little bit more creative as a person. So I've been doing a little bit more social media. I wrote a book. I wrote a kid's book. So, yes. So my goal in life would be for no one to need me as a colorectal surgeon. hopefully that's later on after I retired and, you know, getting a few royalties. But so actually I've written two books now. The first is Mommy, I Made a Boo-Boo. Yes. And they're so this one is focused on, you know, that bowel movements are normal, the process of digestion. It talks about some of the digestive organs. So it's called Mommy, I Made a Boo-Boo. That's the first one. And the second one that just got released earlier this month is Mommy Gets a Colonoscopy. So my challenge to you and all your listeners is actually to start engaging your children these preventative services and conversations early. So when mommy's going to get it, or daddy, or whoever's going to the doctor to get a procedure done, why? So I can make sure I'm, you know, that I'm healthy and strong for you. So Mommy Gets a Colonoscopy is the second book in the series.
Awesome. And that's available where?
On Amazon.
Thank you. Amazon. The provider of all things.
I know. Self-publishing.
I've self-published as well. So Amazon's a great avenue for that. So wonderful. And congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Congratulations on that as well. And tell us more about your practice so that those who may want to seek out your services, how can they reach you?
Sure. So the name of my practice is Colorectal Wellness Center. We're located in Fayetteville. And colowellness.com. That's colowellness.com is the website. And you can find us there.
Awesome. That is wonderful. Ladies, do you have any other things that you want to talk about, bring up?
I guess the only thing I would say is that I appreciate the fact that the books are designed to get kids to understand the importance of wellness. Because I think a holdback for a lot of people is, I go to the doctor when I have a problem.
Right.
And, you know, I know the three of us, you know, we talk about wellness, and to hear that you're talking about that as well mm-hmm. is important for people to understand. It's like, no, we want to see you when you're well. We want mm-hmm. to talk about things you need to do to stay well. Mm-hmm. And if kids kind of get that idea that, you know, that's why I go to the doctor, that's why mommy went to the doctor, then that can kind of perpetuate, hopefully, to the next generation of, you know, more wellness visit and, you know, the elimination of the things like cancer.
And it takes the fear out of it.
Yes, I was just about to say that.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, not only that, but when kids now hear that you're going to the doctor, they may not be as anxious. They know that mm-hmm. going to the doctor doesn't mean a shot every time mm-hmm. or mm-hmm. a surgery or something bad every mm-hmm. time. You can go to the doctor when you're well mm-hmm. and in that case. Mm-hmm.
And it's also teaching, like, the adults through the children,
right? Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, you're reading this book to your kid so your kid can learn, so you can actually, you know, learn yourself, because mm-hmm. there's so, you know, many things that, you know, I just assumed everybody knows everything about the stomach just because, you know, that's what I do. Mm-hmm. And that's what I, you know, mm-hmm. but then you really realize that, whoa, we're way
on
this.
There's a knowledge gap.
Yep,
yep,
mm-hmm. so.
Yep, yep, yep. And I think, you know, a shout out and a plug for women in medicine. I think that we always talk about representation, why representation matters, why diversity matters. And again, it helps to bring a lot of viewpoints and outlooks and perspectives to the table that may or may not get the spotlight sometimes. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that our healthcare system has focused on, and I don't have a problem with that, is sick care, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Attacking diseases, which we needed to do. You know, I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but it's just like we become so focused on disease management mm-hmm. that we have lost, I think, a little focus on wellness mm-hmm. yeah. and how do we prevent the disease that we need to manage. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so it's a balance,
yes.
right? It's not all one or the other. It's wellness and making going to the physician and having procedures done not be so onerous and scary that, oh, they're going to find something. Yeah. Well, more than likely, we won't find anything because you're healthy, but it's that fear.
Yes.
And you want to find something early.
If you're going to find it early, it's better.
Let's find it.
So. Right.
And if you're guarding your pockets, you know, the overwhelming majority of preventative services are covered by your standard premiums that you're already paying for your insurance.
Right. Yeah,
but exactly once you get to the point when you're getting sick, now we're ordering extra texts and that's going to your deductible. Right. And that's what's taking the money out of your pocket. So,
exactly.
you know, you got to put it all in perspective. So yeah, I try exactly. to kind of just meet people where they are and explain why this should be mm-hmm. done this way. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, this has been exciting. And this has been, I think we've gotten as much out of it as I think our audience will have when they get to listen to this. So please stay tuned to wherever you get your podcasts. This episode should be dropping. And so you'll be able to get it fairly quickly. And then we're going to proceed on with our fifth season of this podcast. We launched in the middle of COVID in 2020. And we started with iPhones and a ring light in three different rooms, spread all out. And we are now in a studio.
A fancy studio, may I add.
So we're excited. And so this is why we want to be able to have wonderful people such as yourself. Thank you for bringing a wealth of information, just your personality. And again, why we resonate and why we are just so excited and thrilled for everything that you're doing with your medical practice, with your books, with your family. And so we appreciate everything that you do.
Thank you.
And just want to continue to encourage you. Anything we can do to try to lend you any wisdom that we have. We've been here a little longer than you have. So any wisdom that
Listen,
we can share.
I needed
share.
Somebody to blaze that trail. I don't know if I ever did it alone. So I appreciate, you know, who you all represent to me.
Thank
you.
You may
not really realize it, but you are all great inspirations and truly a guiding light. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. So we hope you have all enjoyed this episode of Take Good Care Podcast. We're so excited that we have had a wonderful guest with us today, Dr.
Our
Erin. Dr. Erin King-Mullins here with us in studio. So thank you for listening. Thank you for checking out our website, rosagynecology.com. Thank you for finding us on all of our social media platforms and for wherever you get your pods. And until the next time, I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Green. Take good care.